Hi everybody, Joey here again and welcome back. So in today's video, I'm going to show you how to build a PVC overflow. Now that type of overflow might sound familiar as I actually did a project on it about 4.5 years ago. For those that don't know, a PVC overflow is a cheap and easy to build overflow made from PVC and used to overflow water from your aquariums to a sump filter below it or for any other use that you might need to overflow water from your aquarium. Typically costs you about $10 to build one and saves you from buying a hang on the back overflow that works on the same principle yet costs more than 10 times more. A PVC overflow also doesn't require you to drill your aquarium and can be added to an already established tank, which many people like. I wanted to revisit this project today and update and address some concerns that some of you had. Now in general, some of you think the PVC overflow is ugly. Which it is. Some of you also found that it doesn't get the advertised flow rate or it eventually loses its prime and stops flowing water, which can be disastrous. Personally, I never have those issues and a lot of people don't. With that said, others have said their fish have gotten sucked down into it and that's definitely not a good thing either. So today I'm going to address all of these issues with solutions as well as some improvements. You might remember that the materials for a PVC overflow require 6 PVC elbows, a T, and about 4 feet of PVC pipe. Sizing depends on flow rates, but we'll get to that later. Typically, this would hang on the back of the tank, with 2 of the pipes going on the inside. The exposed top could suck the fish in, and the fact that 2 pipes forming a U in the tank are another reason you guys don't like it. The version I want to show you requires you to only have 1 pipe in the tank. So I grabbed a PVC pipe twice the diameter of the overflow pipe and will be making a weir out of it. I placed the cap on and drilled a hole just large enough to squeeze the nub of the suction cup on. Then I used my table saw and cut out some teeth. Although a router would work better if you have one, or most of you will just have a drill. And in that case, simply drill out some holes large enough so that your fish can't actually swim into them. Place the holes where you want the water level to be in the tank. The bigger these holes or teeth are, the better. You don't want them restricting the flow. It's totally fine if you don't get it right the first time. You simply will have to do some testing and changes most likely. Now in this example, the big pipe is 2 inches in diameter, and it's the height of the aquarium. The overflow is 1 inch in diameter. It's important that the weir is twice the diameter of the overflow, so you're not restricting flow. The overflow uses 3 feet of pipe with section length being 12 inches long. And of course, everything is cemented together with PVC cement. The weir simply gets placed where you want the overflow to be, and the overflow pipe goes inside it. How you run it down to your sump is up to you. However, in this example, I attached a short pipe so you can see the water exiting. To prime this, you need to fill the pipe full of water and remove air. Now, previously, we added the check valve to the top to do this. That check valve was also used to easily remove air, but this style doesn't need it. This is actually because the inlet to the overflow is far below the water surface, and any bubbles formed from falling into the weir don't travel far enough to get into it. Once we prime the overflow, we turn our pump on. Water will start to flow out. In the event of a power outage, water will stop flowing as expected. When the pump starts back up, the overflow does as well. Now, because we have a weir, we still get surface skimming without the worry of sucking the fish in. We also have less pipe in the tank. Yet, while we are using a single large pipe, it does look a lot better. Especially if we paint it, and that's something we're going to get to. Now, an interesting aspect to this style is that it's far more powerful than the previous version, and a lot more quiet. To give you an example, I started running 200 gallons per hour through this overflow, then added another 400 gallons per hour for a total of 600 gallons per hour. The overflow handled it no problem. And this is a 60% increase over the previous version. Now the sizes I tested were 3/4 inch, 1 inch, and 1.5 inch, and they all flowed 60% more water than the previous version. One thing to look for with a weir though is how far the water is falling into it. You want to aim for it to be falling by about 1 inch. Anything more and the teeth or holes are too small. Anything less and you might not be skimming the water surface at all. So make sure you start off smaller and do some testing. Now to make this look a lot better, I spray painted it with Krylon Fusion for plastic. This made it look a lot better. However, once Krylon Fusion for plastic has cured, it's also non-toxic, so it's safe. If you're still worried about the overflow losing its prime and failing, pick yourself up a Tom's Aqualifter pump. This is like an air pump, but it can also suck and pump water. Drill a small hole in the top loop of the overflow, about 5 millimeter in diameter, and insert a 6 millimeter air line. You'll want the airline to be flush with the inside top of the PVC wall, just like we did with the check valve in the previous version. Ensure you insert the suction side because you want the pump to be sucking out air and water. Apply a bit of silicone around the seal as well to ensure this is watertight. Now to prime this overflow, you just seal both ends, turn your pump on, and it's going to suck out all of the air and fill it with water. Now you'll want to keep this pump on continuously, and it will ensure that air cannot collect in that pipe, making the overflow now fail-proof. This will add about $15 to the overall cost, but as is, the entire overflow only cost me around $10 for what you see. So an additional $15 pump to make this fail-proof is definitely worth it. So how does any of this work, and what are the flow rates? Well, I already did a video on this in the past, and I invite you to check that out for a full explanation. Both versions work the same, so information in it is still relevant. The only difference is the flow rate, so make sure you add an extra 60% to what's advised if you're building the style from this video. So you now have an overflow that looks good, it's powerful, it's silent, and it's fail-proof. Yet, you don't have to drill your tank, and you don't have to spend a lot of money. Now you can have the sump if that's what you're after. Anyways, I hope that you guys enjoyed today's video. I also wanted to thank you for watching, and I'll see you guys next Sunday for a new do-it-yourself project.